Thank you very much. Well, good morning. It's hard for me to, you know, whether it's morning or afternoon, I'm still on Central Time, but good morning, everyone. Glad to be here. I'm proud of the partnership that my company, Advanced Underwriting Consultants, has with North American. I'm tickled that the folks at AFG Brokerage asked me to come here and spend a little time for you, this morning. Rich mentioned that I think we had a long partnership with North American and that you should call us if you need us. And you're probably thinking to yourself, well, what would I call for? My company is Advanced Underwriting Consultants, and we provide advanced sales services to our client companies and their producers. And North American pays the bill for that. So if you're contracting with North American for your North American cases, you can reach us free of charge to you. Now, I know you have a lot of companies that you can work with and a lot of carriers that have advanced sales departments, and I'm not here to poo-poo them. I just want to let you know that we're available through North American to you to help you with your big cases. A little bit about me. It's hard for me to believe I spent 30 years in the life insurance business. I started in 1987 with CNA Life, if you remember that company. Yeah, thank you for that. Appreciate that. In the meantime, I've had a lot of different roles, including having a law practice, working with closely held business owners, working with affluent clients, working with a lot of the same people and helping the same people that you try to serve. And so, from my perspective, I hope that not only the life insurance background, not only the law background, but that that particular law firm background working with your clients can help round out the perspectives and allow me to serve you in the way that that might help you remove some obstacles from your cases with your clients. So the title of today's session, we're going to be together for the next 15 minutes or so, the title of today's session is Six Developments Over the Past Year That You Should Be Talking About Now. And I've started with a why. And I'm sorry about that. While there are six ideas listed here, I'm really only going to talk about four of them. And I'm really only going to talk about the first four. Now, why is that? Well, the last two will get to deal with proposed regulations, and there are proposed regulations for deferred comp and 457F plans that probably don't mean a lot to a lot of people, and the proposed regulations rather than final regulations. If I had an unlimited amount of time, I'd probably talk about tax reform. Because right now, if I talk about tax reform, I can lie on everything and no one can call me on it. Right? Because we don't know if tax reform is actually going to happen. It might. It might be the shape of what it looks like right now. It might be completely different or nothing may happen. Right? And so, rather than spend a lot of time and energy on that part of it, stuff that will go out of date within a day, quicker than milk, right? We're gonna talk about four concepts, four ideas that I think are both timely and timeless. Four concepts that I think are both timely and timeless. Why are they timely? Something happened recently that makes them timely. Why are they timeless? They're timeless because no matter what Washington does over the next little bit, you can still talk about these ideas and they'll still be worthwhile for you to bring up so that you can serve your clients better. All right, let's talk about the first one of these things. Let's talk about split dollar. Show of hands. Who's been in the business longer than me? I've been in the business 30 years. Who's been in the business longer than me? Great, thank you. Appreciate you fessing up to that. How many of you in the old days were in the life insurance business and sold split dollar plans? Okay, tell me about how you sold split dollar plans in the old days. Who did you sell split dollar plans to? Go ahead. This is interactive, by the way. Okay, so you'd sell it maybe to help fund a buy-sell agreement. Where else might you sell it? Key man, would you sell it to the business owner?
Yes.
Why? Why would you sell it to the business owner? Anybody remember equity split dollar? Why would you sell equity split dollar to the business owner in the old days?
So he can buy himself out.
What's that?
So eventually, if he does it right, he can buy himself out.
Yeah, if we're by self-funding, but you might sell it for a pure green sale, which might be up. Doesn't have to do it for everybody. Why else?
Hire that key employee.
Well, yeah, for key employees, but for the business owner himself. One of the reasons we used to sell equity split dollar to the business owners is to allow them to grow cash value in their pocket without them paying income tax on it. That's a big deal, right? It was a way for them to indirectly leak money out of their business, put it in their personal pocket, and not have to pay income tax on it. I'll let you in on something about my world. I get asked questions about that all the time, right? You probably do too. What's the secret? The agent always wants to know, what's the secret? How do I get money, how do I tell my client to get money out of his business without paying income tax on it? Well, we used to have an idea, equity split dollar, where that was possible. We used the split dollar rules to grow cash value in the pocket of the business owner. Well, about 15 years ago, the IRS got wise. And the IRS published regulations about split dollar. And after the IRS published those regulations, it was no longer possible for us to use split dollar for the owner of the company in a way that allowed the owner of the company to put a lot of money, cash value growth in the owner's pocket. So it shut off that idea. And for quite a few years, split dollar plans virtually disappeared. They virtually disappeared from our business. I'm not saying they completely disappeared, but it had to be a really, really, really specific fit for split dollar to work. Now, I think there are two recent situations that changed that. The first situation is a court case that deals with private split dollar, where the tax court, where the IRS was so ticked at the taxpayer, they tried to sue him and say it was something, the split dollar plan was something it wasn't. The taxpayer won. We'll talk about that case. And in the second example, and this is particularly timely during college football season, the second example is the Jim Harbaugh compensation plan at the University of Michigan. So we're going to talk about both of those. We're going to talk about why split dollar fits in both those circumstances. Before I talk about family split dollar, let me ask anybody in the room ever do a family split dollar case? You did. Tell me a little bit, if you don't mind, tell me a little bit about the case.
It was actually a generational skip in the split dollar plan. We used private split dollar to move assets from generation one to generation two, and then we were able to take a discount. But it's much more occupying, more and more popular, as you said, getting money out of the business or moving money with little or no tax generationally.
So Eric,
yes.
Is Eric, yeah, thank you, Eric, I appreciate that. So your case sounds like it's gonna be like the Morissette case, which we're gonna talk about in just a second. But there's a more basic way the family split dollar potentially works. Anybody else have any experience with it? So the basic way the family split dollar works is in conjunction with an irrevocable life insurance trust, okay? So, in the way of background, life insurance, income tax-free death benefit, but if I own a policy personally on my life and I've got high net worth, the death benefit when I die on my personally owned policy, is it in or out of my estate? In my estate, for estate tax purposes. So how do I fix that? ILA, right? Irrevocable life insurance trust. So I have an ILA, irrevocable life insurance trust, be the owner and the beneficiary of a life insurance policy. It's a trust over which I have no control, right? How does the trust get money to pay for the life insurance policy? How do I get money to pay for the life insurance policy?
Crummy gifts.
So the person who puts the trust together,
grantor,
right? The grantor puts gifts into the trust, right? Makes gifts. That's how the trust gets the money to buy life insurance. Well, if it's a really, really big life insurance policy, because they've got a really, really big estate tax problem, how do we get enough money into the trust without worrying about gift taxes?
Borrow.
Well, you can borrow, right? Premium financing is one thing that is potentially available. What's the downsides? What are the downsides of premium financing?
Lender risk, interest rate risk, agent risk not understanding.
Perfect. Great list.
You could borrow from the corporation if they have enough money in it.
You can borrow from the company. Right. No, I'm with you there. Premium financing has its own risk. So if we're trying to control, the gift tax issue, right? We can use split dollar in a family circumstance. We can use split dollar to lower the value of what's being gifted to the irrevocable trust. That makes sense?
That's your Phil Stamper.
We've got special rules for split dollar to lower the gift tax value of what's being given to an irrevocable trust. And that's the traditional way we've used family split dollar. But we can also use split dollar in a multi-generational way. Let's talk about the Morissette case. So here's the fact situation. We've got Clara Morissette, who's a wealthy widow. She's got three sons. And she creates three trusts for the benefit of her sons. And those trusts enter into an agreement with Clara's own living trust to make sure that life insurance is going to be available to help buy out a family business. So there's a split dollar agreement between Clara's trust and her kids' trusts to buy out, to fund the policies needed for buy-sell coverage by the kids between themselves. And if Clara's revocable trust advances $10 million worth of premium, $10 million to each trust, $30 million total. So under that kind of configuration, what's the agreement between Clara's trust and the kids' trust for about repayment? What do you think? On death, it gets repaid. How much gets repaid? What the split dollar agreement says is, at the agreement's termination or the death of the insured, Clara's trust gets back the greater of the premiums advanced or the policy's cash surrender value. And under the split dollar regulations, this kind of arrangement is supposed to be treated as economic benefit regime, which means that every year the kids' trusts recognize that they're getting a gift of the table 2001 cost of the life insurance. We used to call this the PS58 cost. And that's a lower number than the $10 million of premiums that Clara's trust has advanced. So there's a much lower income tax result, much lower gift tax result for the kids' trust. So Clara's essentially able to advance $30 million worth of premium without having to file a gift tax return or recognize a substantial gift tax liability for what's being sent to the kids' trusts. Make sense? Make some sense? Anyway, so the IRS, after Clara dies, the IRS gets ticked off. It decides that these $10 million premium advances should not be treated as a split dollar plan at all. It decides that what Clara has actually done was made a $10 million gift to each one of the trusts along the way, and that's the way that the tax court ought to rule that the transaction ought to be characterized. And so the, obviously Clara's kids don't agree, and so the question goes to the tax court. And the tax court says, look, you guys, IRS, you guys made up the rules. You guys decided that economic regime split dollar ought to be taxed the way that Clara's estate and Clara's trust and the kids' trust accounted for this thing. So it's your own fault, IRS, that we're going to rule in favor of the taxpayer. So from the court's perspective, the taxpayer did everything exactly right. Now, there are a couple of unanswered questions with regard to this case. The first one, the main one has to do with this. So the kids' trusts still owe the greater of the premium advances for all the cash value back to Clara's trust, right? Because that's what the agreement says. That's what they owe back to Clara's trust. And so that receivable, Clara's right to receive the greater of the premium advances or the cash value, that's an asset of Clara's estate. And the tax court case was silent on, well, what's that worth? What's that worth? I've heard some people speculate that it's worth a lot less than the cash value, because there are a lot of things that might get in the way of Clara's estate ultimately collecting that money, right? Those policies, you know, may go underwater, may start going down in cash value, and it's a real risk for Clara's estate. And so maybe the receivable isn't worth as much as the cash value, maybe it's worth something less. So we don't know. We don't know the answer to that, but that's an interesting question. It'll eventually be addressed by the IRS and the tax court on another case. What's the bottom line for this case? The bottom line for this case is that intergenerational private split dollar is a valid concept. It's a valid idea. As you're working with your really high net worth clients, if they're candidates for having the older generation help the middle generation buy needed life insurance, this idea is worth considering. It works a little bit like premium financing, but it's got better upsides. Got better upsides. So it's certainly something that ought to be on your radar as you talk to your best clients. Let's talk about the Jim Harbaugh split dollar plan. Any University of Michigan fans in the room? One, yes, thank you. Great win this past weekend. So Coach Harbaugh at the University of Michigan about a year ago, a little over a year ago, entered into a compensation package which the loan-based split dollar plan that was part of that comp package made its way online and got into my grubby little hands. So I was able to write an article about it when I found it, because it's really interesting for us in our business. And if assuming that what I found online is true, and it looks true, but you never can tell, but assuming what I found online is true, the university was agreeing to advance 6 annual premium payments of $2 million each to the Harbaugh split dollar plan. Now, Harbaugh's not an owner of the University of Michigan. Well, at least I don't think so. Not yet, right? Public university. So anyway, he's an employee. This is a loan-based split dollar plan. In the event of death or termination, Harbaugh agrees to repay the university its premium advances without interest. And that is allowed under the loan-based split dollar rules. Remember, the first case was economic benefit split dollar. This one is loan-based split dollar. You've got two ways to design a split dollar plan. Loan-based works better here, and here's why. Harbaugh's liability to pay back to the university its premium advances plus any loan interest. No, there's no loan interest. His liability to pay back the premium advances is limited to whatever's in the policy. So this is a non recourse loan for HERBA. A non-recourse loan for HERBA. Both parties signed a piece of paper that said to the IRS, the premium advances were likely to be repaid. I don't know whether they are or not. This is one of the requirements in the IRS regulations for you to get this really good tax treatment. So, what does that mean? So, loan regime split dollar plans require the employee to either pay the interest on the loan or recognize as income the unpaid interest. Now, we said earlier, there's no interest on the loan, right? So HERBA is going to pay income tax on the imputed interest on the loan. Now, at the time this agreement went into effect, in June of 2016, the relevant rate was 2.24% on the loan. Each additional premium advance is going to have its own rate depending on what rate is in effect. Interest rates have been somewhat stable, so it's probably in the same neighborhood-ish on the upcoming premium advances, the one that just happened and the ones that are coming due after that. What does that mean? HERBA's got to pay income tax on 2.24% of the premium loan, right? In that first year, the actual imputed income, $45,000, if he's in a 40% income tax rate, about $18,000 of tax.
What's the
face value? I can't remember off the top of my head. I don't think it's said. I don't think the agreement was clear on how much the face amount was. Well, whatever, you know. Run your own numbers, right? You're gonna run a minimum face amount, right? If you want cash value accumulation, you're gonna run a minimum face amount. And so if you're running six premiums of $2 million a year, you're probably gonna run $50 million a face, $40 or $50 million a face, right? At his age, something like that. Does that make sense? Maybe a little less. You might be able to get away with a little less than that. So this case underscores that there's still a place for a split dollar with highly compensated employees. So what are the advantages for HERBA? He gets relatively cheap insurance coverage. You know, if it's a $40 million face amount policy, he gets that for the income tax result in the first year on $45,000 or so. Now that's going to go up as more premiums are advanced, but it's still relatively cheap. The agreement's got the potential to tie HERBA to the school. We'll see, right? But it's got the potential to tie HERBA to the school for the next little bit. Why is that? Why would HERBA feel tied to the school?
Because if he goes elsewhere, he'll be responsible for the premium.
If he leaves, he'll lose the life insurance benefit, probably. He'll just turn it back over to the school. I agree with that. Why else? What's that?
He would need to take the loan back.
Well, he'd probably get the policy back, right? And he probably wouldn't have anything to take with him. You're thinking about the downside. What's the upside for HERBA over the long term?
Tax-free interest.
Right? So, the loan interest rate, 2.24%. Can you think of any life insurance policies that you're selling right now that credit more than 2.25% on the cash value and will perhaps persistently credit more than 2.25% on the cash value over time? Where does the growth on the policy go? Not a trick question. Help me out. Goes to HERBA, right? Goes into his pocket. And again, as people here applied, he's got the ability to access that money on a tax-favored basis through loans right? Which are taxed as long as the contract stays in force. He's got the ability to do that. And the split dollar agreement is actually explicit on this point. Any equity that's in there up to a certain limit, Harbaugh's got the ability to access while he remains an employee of the University of Michigan. So it really is a wonderful thing for Jim Harbaugh. Really no downside risk because it's a non-recourse loan. A lot of upside risk. And from the university's perspective, it ties him there. He's got to be there for several years for him to realize the equity growth in this life insurance policy. So as you think about your clients, you think about the businesses that are highly successful, you think about those businesses that have really key employees, who are not owners, really key employees, who the business owner wants to compensate in such a way that really ties them to the business in an effective way. You gotta think about this. Again, it looks a lot like premium financing, but because the financing party is the business, it's a lot more favorable for the insured than traditional premium financing. There's a lot less risk for the insured and a lot more upside potential. So as you think about that for your clients and the people you want to serve, keep that in mind. So let's move on. I listened with interest as Nate got up and talked about permanent life insurance being the Roth IRA for the uber wealthy, right? Is that kind of what he said? And it ties right into this idea for me. Life insurance, permanent life insurance is terrific. It has terrific tax advantages. What are they?
Tax-deferred
growth. What else? Tax-free death benefit. What else? What's that?
You can borrow
out money tax-free. What else? What's that?
Arbitrage.
Yeah, you can be arbitrage, right? You get cash value growth based on over what you put in if things work out the right way. Withdrawals off the basis are also tax-free. And for certain companies and certain products, you may have the ability to access the death benefit early, right? And get some benefit from some tax-free benefit from that, terminal illness or chronic illness or whatever, right? So those are terrific. So as you are working with a client and making the permanent life insurance sale for supplemental retirement, as Nate suggested earlier, how do you couch that language for your client? What do you tell your client? How do you make that presentation? Stone face.
Cash values in the policy. You could use the loan privilege in the plan to withdraw income out of that plan tax free as long as it is a loan.
Okay. So, Bob, thank you. Bob said, you've got the ability to put money in a permanent life insurance policy, and if it's a non-MAC, I'm going to put a few words in your mouth, right? If it's a non-MAC, cash value grows tax deferred, and you're able to access that cash value by way of loans along the way. Thank you. That's really good. Unless. What's the unless?
MAC and lapse.
What's that?
MAC and
lapse. MAC and lapse. So if you've got a MAC, the rules are different. That's not the court case we've got here. But lapse. What's the deal with lapse?
Phantom income.
Right? So if you take partial withdrawals out of a life insurance policy up to what you put in, those are tax free. If you take loans thereafter, as long as the contract stays in force, those loans are not treated as distributions at all for tax purposes. And then when the person dies, the tax-free death benefit solves everything. But what if a person doesn't die? What if the policy lapses? Well, this is this court case. case of Mallory versus Commissioner. So Mr. Mallory buys in 1987 a single premium variable life policy from Monarch Life. A lot of legacy issues here. Why is the date 1987 significant, all of you old-timers like me? Right, it's pre-7 pay rules, right? They implemented MEC rules in 1988. So you could buy a single premium life insurance policy in 1987 and not worry about it being a MEC, because no MECs did not exist. And what they did was they grandfathered everything purchased before June 21st of 1988 and said it's treated under the old rules. So if it wasn't a MEC before then, it's not a MEC after then. So we have single premium life insurance before the MEC rules. And the policy provided that Mr. Mallory could take loans out of the Monarch Life policy and the policy's cash value would secure the loans. And this is typical. This is what policies still do, right? You're able to get loans and you're able to net out loans up to usually almost all the cash surrender value, right? And this policy did what life insurance policies do in this respect too. Loan interest is added to the outstanding loan amount unless it's paid in cash. Mr. Mallory took the loans, did not pay back any loan interest or pay back any of the loans, and the contract provided that when the outstanding loans exceeded cash value, Monarch would terminate the policy after sending notice to the policy owner. And so over the years, Mr. Mallory took out loans against the policy. And in October 2011, Monarch Life sent him a letter saying, look, your policy is going to terminate, and in order for you to avoid termination, you've got to pay us $26,000 right now. And Monarch Life, being a responsible company, said, if you don't pay this tax, your policy is going to terminate, and we're going to report it as a taxable event to the IRS. Should be a surprise to no one that this is what happened, right? So the Mr. Mallory took no action. The policy terminated in 2011. Mallory gets a 1099 showing a gross distribution of just under $238,000. He doesn't put it on his taxes. His position is, I didn't get $238,000. So the IRS takes him to court to collect the taxes, and by this time, interest and penalties associated with a $150,000 taxable amount. The gross distribution, $238,000, he had some basis in the contract, taxable amount, $150,000. So that's the fight in the tax court. The Mallory said, we didn't get nothing, so we shouldn't be taxed. The IRS issues a notice of deficiency. They want to collect $40,000 in taxes plus a penalty of $8,000. The Mallorys argue with that, and they ask the tax court to decide. The court decides really quickly. The Mallorys got the phantom income that we talked about earlier, and then are on the hook for the tax liability. Even though they didn't get any money at the time that the policy lapsed, they didn't necessarily get any money from Monarch, they got to pay tax as if they got $150,000 in their lapse. Why is that fair?
They had the insurance.
They had the insurance. Why else is it fair? They got loans in the past, didn't they? They got the money in the past. Do they remember that? Are they ticked about it? Who are they looking for? They're likely looking for the agent. Where's the agent?
Dead.
Was that dead? The agent's dead. Not all of them. But, the question of where's the agent is really an opportunity for you, right? I probably don't have to say this out loud to anybody in the room, but I'm going to do it anyway, and that is, you want to keep in touch with your clients, right? if somebody, if an agent had been in touch with the Mallorys sometime before 2011, say 10 years prior, 2001, what could have been done? Might have been able to exchange the plan, although we'll talk about 1035 exchanges and special issues in a minute. What else might have been done? Enforced illustrations might have helped, right? If you got good information from an enforced illustration that showed that the policy was going to lapse in 2011, what might you have done? What might you have encouraged the Mallorys to do? Take less. What else?
Pay more.
Pay more. What else?